Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.' They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12." The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us go forth in the name of peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and also share in his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people.
While Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor.
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her.
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray Jesus to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples said to him,
Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?
So Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, The teacher asks, Where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as Jesus had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, Jesus came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and say to him one after another,
Surely not I.
Jesus said to them,
It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
Take, this is my body.
Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them,
You will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Even though all become deserters, I will not.
Jesus said to him,
Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he said vehemently,
Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And all of the disciples said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated and said to them,
I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake.
And going a little farther, Jesus threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want.
Jesus came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again, Jesus went out and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found the disciples sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. Jesus came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now, the betrayer had given the crowd a sign, saying,
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when Judas came, he went up to Jesus at once and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. Then the crowd laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of Jesus' followers deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. The crowd caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed Jesus at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now, the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against Jesus, saying,
We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in three days I will build another not made with hands.
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But Jesus was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
And then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?
The whole council condemned Jesus as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
Prophesy!
The guards also took Jesus over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth.
But Peter denied it, saying,
I do not know or understand what you are talking about.
And again he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
This man is one of them.
But again Peter denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean.
But he began to curse and he swore an oath.
I do not know this man you are talking about.
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said to him.
Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
And Peter broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered him,
You say so.
Then the chief priest accused Jesus of many things. Pilate asked him again,
Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you.
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now, a man named Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then Pilate answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again.
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
The crowd shouted back,
Crucify him.
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
Crucify him.
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, Pilate handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed Jesus in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him.
Hail, King of the Jews.
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. The soldiers compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then the soldiers brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh. But he did not take it. And the soldiers crucified Jesus, dividing his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with Jesus they crucified two bandits, one on his right, one on his left. Those who passed by derided Jesus, shaking their heads and saying,
Aha!
You who would destroy the temple and build it in three days, save yourself and come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking Jesus among themselves and saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself.
Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe.
Those who were crucified with Jesus also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
Listen, he is calling for Elijah.
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying,
Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down.
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that in this way Jesus breathed his last, he said,
Truly, this man was God's son.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. These used to follow Jesus and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if Jesus were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether Jesus had been dead for some time. When Pilate learned from the centurion that Jesus was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Joseph then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
I have always loved the dissonance of it, even as a kid. I've always loved just sitting with the vivid, visceral experience of the Palm Sunday liturgy. I think the dissonance is by design. I think it might be the point. This service begins with triumph, with Jesus entering Jerusalem and being hailed as King of Kings. The scene is filled with the hope of people who can see the promise of a new era of God's work in their world. And alongside them, we experience that same hope for our world right here and now. But boy, does the story change quickly. Before our arms can even feel the slightest bit tired of being extended above our heads to wave our palm branches in joy, we face the corrupt and power-hungry Roman authorities literally dead set on extinguishing any hope for the oppressed and any threat to the status quo. And so we follow Jesus, the instigator, the provocateur, the enemy of the status quo and of worldly power that oppresses God's beloved. Our mood turns abruptly from hope to sadness and horror at the measures humans will take to look out for themselves. Here we are today in that dissonance. We gather one minute in joyful hope, the next in grief and perhaps guilt. And it's the dissonance that should move us, that should capture our attention. We cannot simply choose hope or grief. We cannot simply hide in the moment of triumphal entry, nor wallow at the foot of the cross. It's the dissonance where we live. We are, after all, human beings, first and foremost, beautifully created in God's image, and yet also quite often obscuring that beauty in our and our world's brokenness. We don't just observe the people in the gospel one day hailing Jesus as their hope and the next fearfully calling for his death. We are those very people. It's why during Lent we take a journey of self-examination and why we shed away needless distractions in order to face the dissonant but grace-filled reality of our human condition. It's how we can get to that deep, deep place of true joy 1 week from now. But not unless and until we make the whole journey this week, so that we neither hide in triumphal palms nor wallow in the darkness of the cross, but rather we embrace this dissonant reality that the only path to the fullness of life is in throwing ourselves headlong into the loving arms of God and giving ourselves fully and completely to following the ways of Jesus. We have spent the last 5 Sundays giving thanks for all the ways God loves, forgives, heals, and strengthens us, even when we sometimes feel unworthy or distant from such love. We considered and prayed over a verse from the appointed psalm each week as a means to discover that sweet gratitude that forms an integral foundation of our faith. We cannot fully know the peace of God apart from actively, tangibly, constantly expressing our gratitude that though sometimes broken, hurt, or lost, God heals, welcomes, and loves. So let's recall our psalm verses from this Lent. The first one was, "Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting." And then, "Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel. All you of Jacob's line, give glory." "The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent." Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. And finally, last week, give me the joy of your saving help again, and sustain me with your bountiful spirit. In other words, as we have made our Lenten journey, we have reflected on God's disposition toward us. God is compassionate when we are suffering. God, the awesome creator of the universe, draws us into close, intimate relationship. God guides us in ways that revive our soul and are the source of wisdom. God delivers us from distress, and God fills us with life-saving joy. And now, we have the tremendous privilege of following Jesus this week on the journey of his passion and death. We get to witness the climax of God's work to heal us, to bring us home, to ground us in our essential identity created in the image of God. We have only one response today, only one disposition to take through this week: gratitude. We've spent this Lent considering how God is with us so that we might see simply and profoundly that the ways God is with us are the ways we are created and called to be with God and with others. We can return God's compassion with compassion for others' suffering. We can deliver others from their distress. We can respond to joy and unending saving help with joyful, grateful generosity of our own. This is our life of faith in a nutshell. If we hope to know and experience the fullness of God's presence and peace, then we can cultivate a life reflective of God's unending generosity towards us in every way. This is why we decided to bring our shared stewardship of this amazing parish into focus during Lent. All through this season, as we have been encountering God's gracious generosity and healing love week by week, I hope we have come to see the tremendous gift we have in this parish and in our shared life. Bethesda is for us the primary vehicle, the essential instrument through which we know and experience and share and celebrate all God does for us through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Indeed, our relationship with our parish, just like our relationship with God, cannot be reduced to a merely transactional dynamic. If we approach God or our parish family as just another service provider who helps us feel better, we will be nothing but disappointed. But we understand that we live, worship, and serve God here. We care for one another here, knowing that we've already been given every good gift by God. Our response then can't be to minimally invest. God comes to us day by day, moment by moment, to call us to a whole new life and to give everything, because we were built to be of generous service far more than we were built merely to be consumers of someone else's service. So today, let's express our gratitude. Let's give thanks. Let's give thanks for the light at the end of this pandemic tunnel, where we can actually see the possibility of gathering in our beautiful church again. Let's give thanks for all the creative ways we've found to share the love of God and to strengthen each other during this past year. Let's give thanks for the ways we've been able to serve those around us who are hungry or grieving or suffering. Let's give thanks by celebrating our great Thanksgiving in the Eucharist. And just as God generously gives healing grace to us day by day, moment by moment, let's give thanks by giving of ourselves, of our time, of our talent, of our treasure, with wild generosity and joy.
On this Palm Sunday, we've come to a special moment in our Lenten journey together. We've been focusing throughout the last 40 days on both gratitude and generosity. Our generosity to God and God's people flows directly out of our gratitude for the many blessings we've each received, especially during this difficult year. I invite you to join with those of us who are here, with our vestry, and with others watching online in making an annual commitment to support all that we do together. You can find a link in the video description or at bbts.org that will allow you to make your annual pledge or estimate of giving. Please know in advance how deeply grateful we are for each one of you and for your commitment to Bethesda.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Peter, our bishop, for the clergy of this parish, and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Joe, our president, for Ron, our governor, for the mayor and members of the town council, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Hunter, John, Rob, Vita, and all who are or recently have been hospitalized, for the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, especially Jose and Tom, for the victims of the shootings in Atlanta and Boulder, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will. And those good things which we dare not, or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving. And make good your vows to the Most High. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, he reconciled us. By his wounds, we are healed.
And therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord God of our holy and righteous forebears, Redeemer and Mother of Israel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe.
The eyes of all look upon you, and you give them their food in due season.
You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God,
giver of life and salvation.
Let us pray. God of love and mercy, you call us to be faithful disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ, and good stewards of all creation. Grant us the grace to understand, the humility to accept, and the courage to respond to the challenges and opportunities we have been given to advance the mission of your church. As we strive to be faithful stewards in making these personal financial commitments, give us also the grace to be faithful stewards of the resources we share in community, the common gifts of time, of talent, and of treasure. In all that we do, help us to be steadfast in faith, confident in hope, and generous in charity. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty and ever-living God,
we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Bow down before the Lord.
Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.